Welcome everybody to another episode of Beyond the Patterns. Today I have a special guest, Professor Dr. Schuller from Augsburg University. He received his diploma, doctoral degree, habilitation and adjunct teaching professor in machine intelligence and signal processing, all at TU Munich, Germany. He is full professor of artificial intelligence and the head of GLAM at Imperial College London, UK. Full professor and chair of embedded intelligence for healthcare and well-being at the University of Augsburg, Germany. Co-founding CEO and current CSO of Ordineering, an audio intelligence company based near Munich and in Berlin, Germany. And permanent visiting professor at HIT China, amongst other professorships and affiliations. Previous stays include full professor at the University of Passau, Germany, and researcher at Johanneum Research in Graz, Austria, and the CNRS LIMSI in Orsay, France. He is a fellow of the IEEE, Golden Core awardee of the IEEE Computer Society, Fellow of the BCS, Fellow of the ISCA, President Emeritus of the AAAC, and Senior Member of the ACM. He co-authored more than 900 publications and has more than 30,000 citations according to Google Scholar and an H index of 85. He is field chief editor of Frontiers in Digital Health and was editor-in-chief at IEEE Transactions on Effective Computing, amongst manifold further commitments and service to the community. His more than 30 awards include having been honored as one of the 40 extraordinary scientists under the age of 40 by the WEF in 2015. He served as coordinator or PI in more than 15 European projects, is an ERC starting and DFG Reinhard Koselleck grantee, and consultant of companies such as Barclays, GN, Huawei, or Samsung. So, very impressive career that Professor Schuller has done in his young age already, and now I'm very much looking forward to his presentation that is entitled Ambient Health Intelligence.
Thank you very much, Andreas, for this very kind introduction. And indeed, it's all my honor to be presenting in this great circle here today. And the topic indeed is ambient health intelligence. So I want to talk a little bit about the idea of AI for health, and in particular, the idea of mobile health put together was also IoT, so surrounding sensors. Frankly, we will mainly be talking about mobile health and just at the end move a bit towards integrating external sensors. So also I try to make it largely about the AI part of things, but I want to just give a brief introduction to motivate the idea of healthcare applications. And that is starting with the idea of modern medicine at medicine 1.0, where you have modern anesthesia, for example, in the mid-1800-somethings, moving to medicine 2.0, where you have an increasing technization, x-rays, for example, and more industrial principles for hospitals. Medicine 3.0, now we're already in the 1980s, was increasing automation, but more of e-health kind of things, such as Puma 200, the first robot used in surgical operations, as you can see here. I hope you can actually see my mouse pointer. And finally, medicine 4.0, where you have information interlinked, semi-autonomous systems, health apps, phones, And that led to the name mHealth, coined by my Imperial College London colleague, Robert Estepanian. At that time, he wasn't with us, now he is. And mobile health is the idea really of making those health apps on the smartphones, but we're integrating AI, as you will be seeing in the oncoming slides, to make this much more powerful than reminders to take your medication. So the idea is to have health intelligence exploiting embedded sensors, embedded artificial intelligence, and use that in your everyday life for healthcare and well-being. Now, this is also the name of our chair in Augsburg, so we're all dedicated to this idea in Augsburg, embedded intelligence for healthcare and well-being. This means that we're essentially at the intersection of computer science / EE, electrical engineering, with mainly the disciplines artificial intelligence, IoT a little bit, and sensing a little bit. You could also say that usability engineering is a part of it, because we have to have things usable. If you have to carry around something or wear all day, it has to be usable. but mainly, we're really looking into deep learning, signal processing, with an application focus on health science. Now, on the health science side, while I am, for example, a second member in the Faculty of Medicine in Augsburg, we're also working a lot together with psychologists, so for digital psychology, if you want, or digital mental health, looking into depression, for example, or addiction medicine. And we also work together with sports sciences, for example, in Keyrun, a project where we look into using AI for making your running experience better, recognizing your well-being during running, and also giving you more accurate locks on the surface you're running upon, and so on. Now, this means that we are exploiting a lot of different signals, and you find some usual suspects when it comes to medicine here, like EEG maybe, or ECG. But you will also find less usual suspects in traditional traditional informatics for medicine. Maybe video really is a classic, but speech and audio, and we will be seeing that a lot in this talk, is not such a classic yet. Though we believe that speech and audio is sort of the new blood in terms of what we can find in this. So essentially, we're looking at your neurobiology, like sleep and arousal systems, motor circuits, emotion circuits, that trigger some behavior that we can measure, like your skin conductance response, your motor activity, autonomic functions, and the likes. And what we're using really is the richness of sensors available on your smartphone, your smartwatch, or other wearable devices. And that is indeed very rich. You have a microphone and you have a camera. And then, of course, you have an accelerometer, you have GPS data, a light and UV sensor. So we could, for example, talking about digital mental health, look into, are you still going outside? With a near-field communication sensor, we can measure if you're still going amongst other people or if you're staying all isolated alone. Biosensors, of course, like skin conductance, heart rate, and so on, blood oxygen and the like, are becoming more and more standard in our wearable devices. Now, adding the Internet of Things means that we can also use ambient intelligence. For example, if you want to use facial expression recognition, you will hopefully not all the time have your camera pointed to yourself with a smartphone, but we could exploit ambient camera, which is around. And we will be seeing at the end other examples of using your smart home appliance usage to infer more about your behavior patterns and irregularities that might give us clues on health states that are worrisome. So the idea is to combine AI and IoT into AIoT, artificial intelligence, with the Internet of Things for digital health. Now, with that, I want to move into the kind of chances and opportunities this opens up. We want to have an earlier diagnosis simply because you're wearing your smartphone, your smartwatch with you all day long. Your general practitioner, GP, may have on average around the world only 7 minutes for you, but we can record you throughout the night and day, always with you. whether it is for earlier diagnosis directly or whether it is just to give the GP more information at hand. What we can do, for example, is here an example of baby vocalizations from 0 to 2 years in the database, and you can see these kinds of different things that we're automatically recognizing, like canonical babbling, canonical syllables, or explorative sounds and the likes. And we can get such a histogram. And you see the average histogram in these two images here for autism individuals and typically developing individuals. Now you can see that they're distinctly different on average. And the way we needed to do this is we needed to look into old home videos from later diagnosis autism or not children to see if it can do a much earlier diagnosis. And in fact, could do this depending on the study as early as 10 months or up to 2 years already with a almost 90% correct recognition rate. So earlier diagnosis and for all is the next promise. For all in the sense of for anybody on Earth, given that they have a smartphone and access to such a software, that of course doesn't mean it's really for all, but at least for many more than have good access to a GP. And of course, spread of such devices is increasing. But it's maybe also for surprisingly many different health states, and I want to give you an impression by coarse estimates of prevalences. So please take these with a grain of salt. It's really estimates for the things we're currently looking into. And this starts with head and neck cancer, multiple sclerosis, Rett syndrome, Parkinson's, cardiovascular disease, epilepsy, autism, depression, Alzheimer's, bipolar and eating disorder, sleep apnea, alcohol use disorder, osteoarthritis, and in fact also COVID-19, which I will have an example on at the end. And you can see with these rough estimates, we're reaching from 2 million to roughly 1 billion of prevalences on the world, meaning that every seventh or so individual might be diagnosed or aided with such a tech. We can do this anywhere. If you just have your smartphone, here's the example of listening into your eating behavior to track your eating habits, as was featured in two challenges we ran, the Eat Challenge, where we integrated audio and video, or at Compare at Interspeech, we ran it with audio only, and you had to recognize from sort of the crunching during your speech, what are you eating and are you eating or not. We can do this in real time. Here you see an example of a demonstrator. I'm not showing because video over Zoom can be tricky, but you can imagine it to recognize your laughter, for example, and just as an activity tracker, this tracks how often you laugh, and it does this in real time on your smartwatch, meaning that you get instantaneous feedback. And a huge advantage of all the mHealth and ambient health intelligence ideas to have the patient in the loop. Here you can see an app where you make a picture of your food. This was a master thesis at our chair, and it was linking into a CNN that recognized the food, gave you immediate feedback from a food database on the composition of macronutrients and the calories in your food to give you immediate feedback what you're about to to take in. And hence get you into the loop and take hopefully better care about your health state in general. Now this moves us to the techie part, and I want to talk first a little bit about the challenges that come with doing health intelligence in the wild and in everyday situations, and then introduce some of the current solutions that we're using. So big challenge comes with the hardware that we're using. Of course, as you may imagine, the data is often noisy. That already starts with heart rate data or skin conductance data, because you might be sweating, you might have hair in between your sensor and your skin. But of course, it's particularly true for audio, video. In video, you have occlusions, changing lighting conditions. In audio, we have over-talk and the likes. But at least a similarly big, if not bigger, problem is missing data. So in a current bigger project in the UK and across Europe, we are collecting data partially of more than 1,000 enrolled patients. For depression, for example, these are patients that want to benefit from such a study. They're even paid And yet we only had sometimes 7% return of data, 7% if people are paid for it and have a real interest in this kind of data to help themselves actually. Why does that happen? I mean, first of all, anything that you have to charge extra, put on extra, is a super huge burden, and your adherence will last maybe only for a few days. But even if you have it fully charged and wear it, of course, you have simply dropouts, for example, for connectivity issues, or because you're forgetting to sync the device and many other reasons. Another big problem is that the major selling point in this domain is selling hardware. It's not so much about software. It's more than half of the revenue created. And this means that manufacturers have to put out their hardware very quickly in new versions, meaning that the sensors that we're confronted with have a short lifespan on the market. And once we got data from it, maybe it's already the next generation that collects data in a slightly different way. Because of the harsh competition on the market, we also have to fight with unknown signals and pre-processing because the manufacturers do not give away all the details, so the raw data is hardly inaccessible. This asks, of course, for end-to-end learning solutions or highly automated learning solutions where we don't need to know what exactly the data is, but as long as we can give data plus a label to the thing and it learns it all for itself, we're well kept. Similarly, we need to have transfer learning in place and good transfer learning mechanisms to be sure that we can exploit the data and re-profit from it when a next generation of hardware is out there. So now I want to move into these kind of solutions here. And the first one is concerning the noise. And what I'm showing here is our toolkits, so you can also find these on GitHub and use them if you want to. For noise, our latest and greatest is Enhance, to give it a German flavor, but it's an enhancement toolkit, so signal or speech enhancement, but you can feed in any kind of signal. Enhance is built of a residual network, which is recurrent in its nature, and the main block here has a fully connected layers set at the end of the network and basically goes from a mixture spectrum to estimate the denoised audio. What is important, however, is that we have a possibility here to embed information, and we have two sides here, left and right. The left side is used to embed target context. The right-hand side is used to embed interference context. Now, what does it mean? It means that I can asynchronously integrate information on the target and the interference. For example, if I'm sure that only one is present at a time, I could embed it, and if later both are present, this side is not updated here, but so this side here in the middle, this block in the middle, profits from the embedding of knowledge on the interference or target. Or because you know your voice and you have some sample from beforehand, you'd simply give here some target context embedding from your voice and you do not update, but still you have some information for the network at hand, what your voice should usually sound like. Now I have some audio examples, which I hope you can hear. Well, we have 0 dB, so the worst, well, not worst case, negative SNR would be worse, but challenging setting where interference and target have the same level and are both of the same gender, and this sounds like this.
Carry as well, because the actual word is where he dropped. Sound.
You know, after separation, it sounds like this.
And there was a game where he dropped.
And I hope you could hear the voice is largely separated. The other one is largely eliminated, but of course you have some artifacts given the severity of this separation. In the second example, we have a slightly more forgiving case, mixed gender, but still 0 dB SNR.
Not a narcissist.
Even now it's in the audience's hands.
That would be brilliant. Over the line.
We believe in it.
And after separation.
All that you can do now is in the audience's hands. We've worked really hard and we believe in it.
And again, I hope you could hear that the female's voice was largely missing after separation, and you can see here some benchmarks against other latest approaches, deep clustering, deep attractor, and enhance, for example, an SDR, signal distortion ratio being way ahead. So this is already, if you listen to it, very encouraging, meaning that if you want to do audio-based or other signal-based in the wild health measurement, we can separate our target in signal of interest very well. Now, moving to the missing data, we are using, again, deep learning these days. We have here a simulation of a package loss, where we have a non-lossy state and a lossy state. This is a general model. Some models have also a third state where you have a burst loss simulated and you have a transition probability to go from non-lossy to lossy and backwards. So this is just for the simulation of the package loss, and here we have a bidirectional recurrent long shorter memory neural network with some trick that I can't say too much about it, but really it's a bidirectional LSTM network to estimate using past and future context, if you can be non-causal, to replace what is missing. So here in the lower plot here, we're seeing the time signal. the green curve is the original signal. And in this region here, the signal is left out. So we're trying to estimate it. Zero concealment would mean that you simply assume no signal at all. Linear interpolation is first sample and last sample that you have interpolated linearly. Of course, it hardly makes any sense if you want to interpolate something like a speech time signal or other sensor signal. But you can see the blue line here is what ConcealNet gives you. And of course, it's not perfect, but it's surprisingly good what it reproduces. You can also listen to it. I don't have an audio example now with me, but it really makes sense, for example, for speech. What I do have, however, is a benchmark where we use this package loss simulation here to drop frames and then see how well we can recover with ConcealNet the missing information and recognize, for example, emotion from the voice, one of our favorites here, arousal as a continuous task and valence as a continuous task. If you do not have any loss, we would have 0.77-ish here as a concordance correlation coefficients for arousal recognition from the voice. And you can see with ConcealNet, we can have almost the same result even at 50% loss, where a linear interpolation would clearly drop already to 0.59 and ConcealNet still gives you 0.75. It's maybe even more visible for the more challenging task of valence assessment from the voice. You can see original, all the audio available. It's a very challenging task, 0.43. If you lose half of the information, linear interpolation goes down to 0.14, whereas ConcealNet still gives you 0.4, very close to as if you had it all. In other words, if you lose half of the material, we're still well off for emotion. We're lacking other health tasks experience, but my feeling is that this is a very useful approach to cope with that. Now I said, the next one is we have an unknown signal in pre-processing, and what we do here is simply end-to-end learning. While this is now pretty familiar, we have 2016 been the first to introduce it in this field, in speech processing for speech analysis in particular, with our end-to-you toolkit, which you can also find on GitHub. We have been giving templates for networks for speech and for vision, for example, also for physiological data. And we could be showing at the time for our AVEC challenge data on Ricola that we could get very, very impressive benchmarks. At the beginning, we were feeling they're too good because they were twice as good as traditional features. Then the race was on and we found similar good constellations with traditional features. But in our more recent challenge events where we use NTU as a benchmark and when participating in other challenges, as recently in the Addressee challenge for dementia recognition, we find that it seems more and more like we cannot live up to end-to-end learning any longer with traditional features. So this is more and more not only for the sake of not having to have traditional features at hand, but really for better performance, that we use a raw audio signal or raw image sequence and give the label, and the network self-learns the representation part and the actual decision-making part. Now, this sounds better than it is because it said you still need these templates, and you can see that the vision part of the convolutional network, vision part, is very dissimilar from the speech part. So you still have to have some knowledge on the architecture that you have to have. Here again, you can see arousal and valence plots like in the dropout example. where red curve is gold standard and dashed line here is the predicted value, and the network self-learns to do a very decent follow-up on that. So here is the GitHub QR code for N2U. It learns, of course, with convolutional layers filters in a hierarchical manner to learn to represent the problem rather than using pitch or something in speech or whatever ZipDuff features in computer vision. So we have these kernels here, and we can use attention to learn where in the input, which for speech could be 1D signal for the wave or for other sensor signals, or it could be a spectral temporal representation like a spectrogram. We have attention here to learn what to look at. Now, another self-learning toolkit for representation learning is ODEEP. ODEEP is a decoder architecture, or sort of an autoencoder architecture, where we have a recurrent neural network. Our encoder RNN gives the final encoder state into a fully connected part, and the decoder final state then feeds into a decoder RNN. And with a linear projection, we have a reconstruction. And we're optimizing, of course, to have a good reconstruction. So we pre-train we train our representation without any label information. If you're processing speech, we're running speech in abundance through such encoder-decoder architecture to find a representation. And then we have our feature generation from the decoder part and use this as an input feature vector for classification. ODEEP is also largely used in our challenges as a benchmark toolkit and also provides very competitive results. Depending on the challenge, it even sometimes produces the best results. Now, what to do if we do not have enough data? That's very prevalent, if I may use medical terminology in our field. Now, COVID-19 is a recent example. We wanted to have solutions ready very early on in March, ideally, and we had almost no data. So we started to use pre-trained networks, again, something that is not so outrageous any longer, but in early days in 2017, we have been the first in the field in audio, for example, to use this for speech analysis and provided our deep spectrum toolkit. In the deep spectrum toolkit, what you're doing is you're translating an audio wave file into a spectrogram here. You can use different color maps. Now that sounds a little bit weird, why different color maps, but simply because we then feed it into an image pre-trained network, and different color maps really make a difference. You can also choose different representation forms, spectrograms or wavelet based representations or cochleograms or whatever. So the Deep Spectrum Toolkit provides you different representations to go from 1D signal to 2D representation, feeds that into a image processing network such as VGG, ResNet, GoogleNet, name it, and uses the pre-final layers, so not the ultimate layer, but the penultimate layers as features. So the ultimate layer would be something like cloud, bus, sky, sun, whatever, but the pre-final layers are high on the semantic level in terms of kernels that have been learned and give some sort of feature representation. This is, however, the tricky part, which of those to use. In our first approaches, we use the two final pre-final layers. I will also show in the next slide an example where we also used further activations from earlier into the game layers. Those we feed into whatever classifier, could be a recurrent neural network or a support vector machine. And here in our first attempt, we had been showing that you can use it for snore sound recognition. Using acoustic features, we have been using the activations of image pre-trained networks. This has been better than a baseline with traditional features. It has been better than end-to-end learning even, simply because we had more data for representation learning. We have later been showing that Deep Spectrum, the toolkit, can also be used for speech, and had gotten at least equal, if not above, rates in comparison to traditional features and back of audio words, which is more fair maybe because you're also injecting data to the learning process. Now, as said, these days we're not only using vision nets, but also audio and sound pre-trained networks, and we're more and more looking into other pre-trained networks. For example, Wave2Letter is a pre-trained speech recognizer trained on 1,000 hours of speech. Here we have been using it on the e-challenge that I have been mentioning before, so recognizing the type of food that you're eating. And these were winners of the challenge here, or the two most competitive results. We have not been participating because we were the organizers, but we could show that was using pre-trained audio nets, we could by a large margin beat those end-to-end learning systems and other deep neural network approaches. Now, as said, the real problem here is to find in Wave2Letter in our pre-trained audio network the right layers to use as activations. So again, the e-challenge has maybe 7 or so hours of material. We're using a 1,000-hour pre-trained network for ASR, and we're using the activations in the network, and we had to pick the right layers, and we had to find a way to identify the layers. It's still not very elegant, I have to say. In the end, it turned out that layer 3, 6, 9, and something at the end were very good to use. We're using compact bilinear pooling to put these together in a compact representation. And I'm pretty sure that you can do smarter here as well to find a representation that is more compact. Now, of course, you can also use generative adversarial networks to do a kind of nonlinear data augmentation. So better than just flipping, mirroring, whatever, speeding up if it's audio or slowing down your material. You can use a non-linear transformation, and of course neural networks are great for that. So we're using generative adversarial networks to augment our training data. We have started doing this augmenting feature vector. So rather than trying to produce new audio or new physiological signal data, we just augmented the feature vector. And again, coming back to arousal and valence as a benchmark on our audiovisual emotion challenge task, you can see that we could heavily improve the performance of an end-to-end learned system by augmenting feature vector observations with a generative adversarial network. For arousal, the easier task, this is still remarkable, but it's very remarkable for valence, the challenging task. We almost doubled the, or we did actually double, the performance in terms of concordance correlation coefficient. So if you're not too familiar with GANs, what they do is that you have a generator that generates new observations and a discriminator that recognizes if it's coming from the generator or is a real world sample from a database, gives a feedback to the generator such that the generator knows I'm not good enough yet and I have to be better at this. A conditional adversarial network is where you also impose a condition which kind of data has to be generated. Now you can inversely to a discriminator where we had been going from the spectrum of the audio down to a representation, move from some random initialization or targeted initialization to a spectrogram. And if you walk our way to spectrograms and a sequence of spectrograms, we can produce audio, for example. So these days, rather than producing feature observations, we're really producing new audio. And here is a conditioning we conditioned on phonemes to have a neural network count up.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Now you think this isn't spectacular, my Siri talks to me, maybe even in better quality, but these are new voices, these are not concatenated speech samples, but it's really a voice completely generated by a neural network that has not been existent from speakers beforehand. And now the whole deal is that we can generate also data in different emotions, different health states, such as having Parkinson's or not, or having COVID-19, being tired, being drunk, whatever you want to condition it to. And that opens, of course, a whole new box of possibilities to synthesize speech. The other way that we're doing it is not generating new data from scratch, but rather convert for augmentation. At this year's ICAST, we have been showing StarGANs to do an emotion conversion of the voice. Same principle, we want to augment our training data, and hence we're going from, let's say, a neutral sample to different emotions, or from a non-COVID-19 tested person to somebody who would sound as if she or he had COVID-19, to then have more training data at hand. Now you can see in these two examples here, in the upper line here, a sad original, converting it to angry, converting it to sad despite being sad. And you can see this seems reasonable. It doesn't change anything much. And to happy. Second example down here is a happy original, converting it to angry, and so on and so forth. Now, of course, we're interested in two things. How does this augment the data? Does that actually work if you add converted samples to the training bag? And how do humans perceive that? Now, starting with the first question, we have been using this on the iEmoCap emotion database, very popular database. And we could show that for the macro F1 measure, the main measure on this database, we could go, if we use the original data and convert the data together, up by 6%, that's quite significant. What is maybe even more striking is that even with only converted material, we could get the same or slightly better result than as if using the original data. Of course, we have been using original data in training the star again, but still it means that we're only using afterwards converted data and still get the same result as if we had used for training the emotion recognition, the original data. If you look at results from humans, we have two tasks that we confronted them with, a two-class task and a three-class task, and they had to give a score how much they perceived it was the correct class. The long story short of this graph here is it did work in those examples where you have a positive score here, so converting angry to sad did work for a three-class and a two-class problem. The baseline, meaning it is unconverted, should be very negative. And we also see that some of these tuples did not work well. For example, going from sad to happy in a conversion did not work well. It was not perceived as correct. Also, angry to happy did not work well. That is usually to be expected because acoustics valence tasks are very difficult. So valence-based conversion is also difficult. So what do we have from that? We can use transfer learning and exploit pre-trained networks, and we can use GANs, generative adversarial neural networks, to augment the training data in better ways than just flipping and rotating images or spectra or whatever, because we use neural networks as a nonlinear transformation to produce new training observations. Now, what we're also using, and I mentioned this already, is attention mechanisms. Attention is good to focus the network like you would with your eyes on the important parts. It's also good for explainability because we can see which are the most important parts. We're using different types of attention that I don't want to go into detail with, but give you an example where we use a convolutional neural network for text processing. We have the text represented as word embeddings, meaning that each word in a sentence has a vector trained on large amounts of data to sort of show how each word in the vocabulary relates to all the other words in the vocabulary. And the attention mechanism here can be used to interpret which words the network in a sentence pays attention to. This was a sentiment task, meaning we recognize if you like or dislike something, and the color coding here shows us, for example, that in this sentence here, the network paid most attention to beeindruckendsten, so most impressive. It paid a lot of attention to best, but it did not pay so much attention to first. Here it's even more obviously making sense. The network pays most attention to the word boring. If you'd like or dislike something, boring is clearly a keyword. Did not at all pay much attention to the water tap, jetzt am Wasserhahn, and we can see that we can not only gain something in improvement of results, but we can also gain interpretability. Now that is attention in the convolutional part of the neural network here, where we learn the representation. You can also use attention in recurrent decision-making parts of a network. here we're trying to model the different tasks that we're interested in side by side. So it's a multitask learning problem for emotion, arousal valence dominance, and we're using attention also in the time domain. What that gives you is attention weights over time. So you have the waves here for audio, two different audio samples here, and you can see two different attention patterns over time for the same audio wave here, depending on the output phenomenon that we're training. So remember, we had several output nodes, and for the arousal node and valence node, we get different moments in time the network pays attention to. So this makes a lot of sense. It improves the quality on both ends for attention during representation learning, for attention during temporal profiles. And we're doing this since recently in a hierarchical manner. For example, if you listen into your words, we're using frame level attention and then word level attention. So we're not using it globally over all the time, but we're having it broken down hierarchically, which makes sense on word level and frame level within a word to learn attention profiles. Now, the next thing that we often have to deal with in medical phenomena is uncertainty. Why? Because our ground truth is not always solid. If you think of COVID-19, we want to train with COVID-19 plus minus results, but you know from the press that these results are sometimes wrong or erroneous. So the first two THROP tests might be negative, the third one is positive, and already from that we have uncertainty. It gets much more uncertain if we have subjective phenomena such as depression or anxiety disorder. So we have to base it sometimes on self-assessment. We have to sometimes base it on assessment from 2 to 3 to 5, whatever, specialists. And this kind of uncertainty can be used during the training. We have here a Bayesian deep net as a teacher network, where we have the rate of disagreement or the uncertainty somehow, as in the several repeated tests, fed into a source model together with the data and labels. And this source model models and gets information on prediction error, model noise, and label noise fed into a teacher model that outputs the informativeness of the current sample to then decide how to weight the current sample during the training of your actual decision-making learner. So in other words, this down here would be the machine learning model that makes a decision on your having COVID-19 or not, or on your depression severity. And during its training, we use the rate of disagreement and these kinds of errors here to judge on the informativeness on the sample and judge by that on the weight given to the sample during the training of the final decision-making instance. Now we have been showing again on the audiovisual emotion recognition from the audiovisual emotion challenge task for audio and for arousal and valence here, how much can be improved by such a model. An end-to-end learning system is the baseline, and we're looking at the more challenging parts here. Valence from audio and arousal from video to have weak initial learners and introducing the uncertainty information into the learning process. You can see good improvements using model uncertainty, label uncertainty, and finally the teacher model gives you a 0.60 to 0.70 roughly improvement in the audio task here. The video task, we also have an improvement. So modeling the uncertainty during learning seems to make a lot of sense. What you can get for free from that is that you can also output for a new sample the estimated uncertainty of your result. So you can also use this as a sort of confidence measure. And looking at the informativeness plot here, we can see that it finds often high informativeness for values which are far off. So in that sense here, neutral samples are less informative than more extreme cases. It's just one visualization that you can look into. The other one is that usually more decided cases are less informative than less agreement cases. Now, we have also been using autoencoders and other ways to encode the informativeness, or the uncertainty, meaning that we train alongside the decision-making instance an autoencoder where we run all our training materials through. Then we have our new sample, which we also run through the autoencoder, and we calculate the Euclidean distance between output and input as a measure of how dissimilar is my current observation from what my system has been trained upon. And we have different ways of integrating this. We can either use the whole reconstruction as an input vector. You can imagine that that is pretty big and not so useful. We can only use a principal component or a number of principal components or only the Euclidean distance between output and input. And we can also co-learn the perception uncertainty as input to give the uncertainty as much space as needed in the network. But the whole message really here is it's great to include the uncertainty as an input information in the decision-making process and in the learning process. Now, ultimately, then we're uniting several modalities, for example, a camera, audio, and physiology from the wrist-worn device, for example, heart rate and audio, as we're trying to do at this moment for some certain health states. If you even have a camera, we include that too. Here you can see different feature layers where we're having these different template kind of networks for the different modalities, could be larger or smaller, if you remember from the end-to-end learning. Then having some context layers, for example, patient records, and then also trying to predict other information on the patient to get the complete view on the patient. Finally, a number of output information that we're interested in here, for example, the emotion and the engagement of autistic children with a tutoring system to teach them about emotion. But the same principle here, uniting with different sizes and depths, modalities, feeding in context information, and then trying to do a holistic modeling with several output nodes for other health states. Now you can do this in different kinds of fusions, early, late fusion, model level fusion, multitask learning, and joint training. And we have been playing a lot around with these different kind of representations. Recently working a lot into cross-model triplets and MO embedding with shared layers. I wanted to highlight in particular one fusion algorithm because the data that we're having is often highly asynchronous. Usually to synchronize this kind of information, we would be using a dynamic time warping. Now we're not looking into dynamic time warping in the traditional way because we're having heterogeneous sensors. So we can't use whatever Euclidean distance or something like easily, but instead we're using correlation by a CCA. And we combine it with the idea of deep learning by using a deep learning network here for the spatial transformation. So the temporal alignment here happens in a sort of similar to dynamic time warping alignment here, but as said, with correlation as a basis, because we have, for example, audio and video to align, and the spatial transformation happens with deep neural networks. We formulate this in a cost function that unites the temporal and spatial aspects. And with this algorithm, deep canonical time warping, we could show that the error here, the alignment error, could be reduced in a number of different tasks. Here, the fusion of depths, thermal imagery and normal RGB cameras in comparison to alternatives that you could be using. We've also combined this with attention here. So, for example, we're aligning audio and video in asynchronous video streams, and you can see that it's using attention here to learn which parts in the image are important. That is good because it means that in the alignment, we can use all these kinds of ideas shown previously, self-learning of the representation, attention mechanisms, and the like to do an optimal alignment and become much, much better in alignment error. Now, if later during usage, we do not have all modalities at hand, can we still be exploiting other modalities during training as a concern or interest of ours recently because we want to have as many sensors in the day-to-day health sensing as needed for adherence reasons. As said, you do not want to wire up yourself like crazy. If you are a runner, for example, you might have experienced these days where you had smart shirts, smart socks, and so on and so forth. At the end of the day, it's a hassle before you can finally go running and you leave it all at home because one of these devices at least is not charged, one is not correctly attached, then setting up all the Bluetooth and so on. So the idea is during training, we use all these modalities because it's not with the end user, but as a data collection, we can do that. Can it still benefit you if later on you have only part of that available? So this is MOBET, our approach where we had, for example, audio and video available for training a neural network with shared layers here to train from the weaker modality with information from the stronger modality. Again, this numbers here, if you remember, can show that this embedding of a second modality, even if you leave it out during later recognition, can help a lot. That leads, of course, to the idea of cross-model self-supervised learning, where you can also try to use one stronger modality for the other during learning, even though you don't use it later on. And finally, this moves us towards lifelong learning. So we went from single task to multitask, as you've seen in the networks, where we try to get a holistic picture of the health state of a person and everything else. You've also seen transfer learning, where we use pre-trained networks to inform on another task. And finally, we have lifelong learning, where we have this feedback loop here to keep learning, but try to avoid catastrophic forgetting of what we have been learning about a task in the past during transfer, and still be able to reasonably learn on top of that. We're using elastic weight consolidation in our tasks here and have been able to show that if you go for emotion recognition, across different cultures, we can, in a lifelong learning simulation, add more and more data in gradually from the new culture. So for example, French and German, and get a huge improvement by using this kind of lifelong learning as opposed to the other kinds of learning. Now, in health, you usually do not want to be told that you're having cancer or COVID-19, and that's it. You want to have some information more than that, and of course, explainable artificial intelligence is what it needs to do more than that. I'm just showing you a couple more things than I had already shown by interpreting attention and considering our convolutional and recurrent neural network as sort of black box here. What we have been doing is correlate the activations of the convolutional part with traditional features. This was for emotion recognition from the voice, and we found top correlations for prosody, so for energy, range, loudness, pitch, mean, meaning that the network has self-learned to look at something like prosody, and we can also interpret the time profiles by inverse Jacobian analysis of the recurrent part here. So how do I weigh in decisions from the past, or if I have a non-causal decision making from the future to make a decision at this moment in time here, depending on each feature dimension individually. So per feature dimension, we get a time profile, how much information from the future and past is being used. Then we need to be efficient, and if we need to be efficient, this can have two reasons. One is because we have a client-server architecture. We do not want to send a lot over the network. That has an added benefit that if you compress the information before sending it over the network, we increase your privacy. We are using our open crossbow toolkit to do a vector quantization, and that means that we use for each feature vector here the nearest bycodebook entry. This is, of course, a toy dictionary, only 5 entries. In reality, it's thousands of entries potentially, but still we have an integer number rather than a float or whatever high-dimensional feature vector. And if you do not need to know the order of events here, we can just transmit a histogram counting how many times did which feature vector occur. this gives you a slight degradation, of course, as you're reducing the information in the beginning. It can even be an improvement because you're having higher generalization potentially. But we have been measuring in our tasks here that we can go down by the order of a tens and compress the information here at similar recognition performance. Now, just to mention, we have originally been doing this with traditional feature vectors, back of visual words, back of audio words, but we have now moved to also apply this for back of deep words, meaning that we're using, for example, if you remember in transfer learning with the deep spectrum toolkit, activations of neural networks, and then have a feature vector of activations from the neural network, and then use vector quantization to compress it into back of deep words. And that works like a charm. On the other hand side, if you do not have a client-server distributed approach, we need to be efficient with the network size on our devices. This is a recent InterSpeech paper as an example, where we have squeezed our networks to recognize a code from your voice to fit onto your smartwatch. Of course, we're doing similar things to recognize emotion on your smartwatch or likes. And the very two most basic things we're doing is truncate here and turn our float or whatever weights of the neural network into integers. Of course, you can do a more smart quantification where you adapt to the presence of different ranges in your number space per layer. But the most basic you could be doing is just use integer here. Then the next thing we're doing is sort of using pruning here by low weights to reduce the number of connections in the network. Already putting these very two simple things here together helped us reduce the size of the network from 230-ish megabytes down to 12 megabytes, so a reduction by 95% at the same performance roughly. So this is a huge improvement, of course, in size of the network, of course, also in recognition speed if you have a smaller network to recognize with. And other methods exist, like a teacher-student architecture, similar to the one teacher-student architecture I've been showing for uncertainty. So thankfully, you can do a very aggressive compression of the networks and still have similar outcomes. Here is a non-audio example where we had deep lesion approach for a lesion detection, so image-based lesion detection, and we could compress not as impressively, but at least to a third roughly of the parameters with an even slightly improved outcome. And it's that improved outcome simply because you're able to maybe generalize better as you're reducing potential overtraining artifacts. Now then another concern is privacy. I'm going with the example of speech here. Maybe we're interested in recognizing one thing from your speech, like COVID-19 or so. I'm showing here what we have been recognizing over 12 years in challenges organized at InterSpeech from the voice. We don't need to go into detail really, but you can see that we can hear from your voice if you're sincere or not. What is your native language? Are you eating something? Are you drunk? Are you tired? Well, not perfectly well, but at least to some degree. Also your personality profile and many other things. So if you just want to hear if you're a Parkinson's early candidate or if you're suffering from Alzheimer's dementia, we need to bear in mind that a lot else is in your speech signal. And you might not want that all to be accessible to others and preserve your privacy. So if you've seen the movie Ready Player One, you might know a scene where he's using emotion hiding software in a video communication. Now I can reveal a secret. You're not seeing my original facial expression and hear my original audio because I'm very nervous giving this talk. But you can hear emotion suppressing software. No, I'm just kidding. But the idea is that you would use real-time processing to hide your health information. You can do this either only for the AI, and at ICASP here, this year we have again been showing adding adversarial noise to fool an AI on your emotion, for example. That's similar to adversarial attacks, of course, elsewhere, where you fool an AI to recognize a dolphin instead of a car or whatever. Here we have been successfully transforming, for example, for the AI, something angry to happy. But to humans, perception, it's not perceivable, so it still sounds very angry, but the target AI is fooled. And if you remember the conversion, of course, you could also think of actually for humans, change the audio in a way that your phenomena are not audible any longer. Then coming somehow back to low data, one of the bigger challenges and things we want to do more is reinforcement learning. if we do not have enough labeled data, we want to learn together with the target user. In particular, if you're wearing a device like a smartwatch or carrying it around like a smartphone all day long, it would be some real big lost chance if you did not do reinforcement learning together with you. We have been showing reinforcement learning for multimodal engagement recognition of autistic children. Recently, we have been using facial expression, body posture, physiology, and audio, and did a reinforcement learning for improving the recognition of engagement with the children over time. And you can see we went up by 30% almost. So this is very, very significant. And we hope to have much more reinforcement learning use in other health tasks or health relevant tasks. We're also looking into federated learning to preserve your privacy by not feeding back your full audio video sensor signals, but still having everybody benefit from your information to have everybody's models improve. Again, thinking of COVID-19, we want to have very quickly improved models. But maybe as a user of a service that recognizes COVID-19 from audio or coughing, you do not want to feed back your real audio. So what you're feeding back is just after local training of your networks and local fine-tuning, the changes of weights in your network to everybody else. To our surprise, again, this was working partially even better in tasks we considered than using the original material. Why? Probably again, because you have some sort of regularization in here, so you're avoiding overfitting. So the baseline here was using everybody's original information, audio-video material for emotion recognition. The federated learning means that we only used everybody's weight updates, local weight updates communicated back to the server. And of course, no learn here means that we did not adapt the original network. So having everybody's material at hand was a huge improvement, but surprisingly, federated learning went even above having everything else. So this works, and apparently very well. So maybe I'm just, in the interest of time, skipping this part and move directly into application. And I said I wanted to show a little bit of non-directly wearable things. Here we're looking into using ambient appliances in your smart home. This isn't really smart because we're just using your TV and your fridge and your usage of the TV and the fridge to infer your behavior. We had elderly users enrolled in Tokyo with our colleagues at the University of Tokyo to make a decision on their appetite, pain, or sleep quality deterioration. So we had 100 participants enrolled, 76 which we could use at the end. Over 1 month's time, we were recording their fridge and TV usage. And they had a questionnaire filled in every day in terms of their appetite, pain, and sleep quality. And if any of these went to a bad condition, we had a symptom case, otherwise a non-symptom case. Now you can't expect magic from that, but you can use a deep neural network and end-to-end learning from your fridge and TV usage and get above chance level. Here we're close to 60% and chance level is 50%, depending on different representations. we partially had results again around 60%. That's only two appliances, but the whole idea now, of course, is if you add more to that, for example, already adding the light to that and your light usage would give you a lot of information on your sleep quality, of course. And you can imagine that in the smart home of the future, we will have a lot of such information available. And the idea then is really to combine your wrist-worn sensing with the ambient sensors around, inject AI to fuse this information and get a very rich picture. Now, these days, the most pressing use case of course is COVID-19. And I just wanted to say this is the last example. We're having two approaches here to recognize potential COVID-19 screening or even pre-diagnosis. The first one is based on recognizing audio events from your phone or your watch, like breathing difficulty, like nasal congestion, coughing, sneezing, sore throat, and the likes. some of which speak for COVID-19, some of which speak more for influenza or cold. And we do a histogram, let's say overnight or during the daytime. And depending on the histogram degree, we get an indication for COVID-19 or rather for influenza or cold. In other words, if you collect a lot of sneezing sounds, we know that it is a cold and rather not COVID-19. If you collect a lot of dry cough, we know that it's rather COVID-19. So this app is sort of ready, and you can choose to make a new recording after enrolling, and then you get a histogram at the end of the day with your sneezing, coughing, and the likes. And what is important now is because we want to have data collected very quickly, we do some active learning, decision-making, which of the collected samples are most informative to be fed back to everybody or to the model update. So rather than as in federated learning here, we're feeding back the original audio, but we decide on 5 only or even 3 only. So you can choose how many you want to donate, and it plays back 3 examples. You listen to them and you decide yes, no to donate them. And that way we don't overburden you by donating when donating, but we get your labels. This is really a coughing, this is really a sneezing, and then you donate your data. We have been showing first results at 83% for the symptoms in the wild, recently appearing on different television here, for example, in India. And we're now hoping with this to get more interest in people donating and enrolling this more broadly due to the current urgency. We've been going a little step further and try to directly from the voice recognize if you have COVID-19 or not, and the severity, but also your fatigue of COVID-19 patients and anxiety levels. And you can see in some way this is working. For example, from speech directly binary decision, we have currently observed 81% three-way severity, 68%. But of course, we need a lot more testing. And of course, we need systems that work in the wild, and all these challenges that I have been mentioning come then, of course, into play. So, with all that said, let me give you a little outlook. We have been seeing a lot of opportunity coming with ambient health intelligence, combining your body-worn sensor signals, combining your ambient sensors in the smart environment and AI to sense health earlier on for anywhere, anyone, anywhere, anytime. But we need, in my eyes, much richer multisensorial and multimodal IoT exploitation than just the fridge and the TV in the example. And that requires, of course, a lot of seamless integration of information. We need a much more holistic health assessment. Right about now, we're going for one task at a moment, Alzheimer's, dementia, or COVID-19. But of course, there's a lot of codependency of symptoms. So hence, we need to have a real holistic approach to that. We need to have a better adaptation. I've been showing reinforcement learning to adapt to an end user, but we need to do this much more longitudinal if you really wear your health device day to day to really have a good adaptation to the user. We need to have better context integration. And I've been showing to you self-learning and end-to-end learning. I haven't shown to you automatic machine learning, but we have also been self-shaping architectures of neural networks with auto machine learning. All of this produces a lot of computational efforts, and it produces a lot of reusable stuff, features that have been learned, models that have been learned, even architectures that have been learned in automatic machine learning, which should be shared in much more streamlined and efficient ways. It's a little bit like recycling maybe for AI, and we have to be much, much more efficient in reusing all the computation and data that has been already well wasted. Then we need to be two things. On the one hand side, much more efficient to learn from very few examples, like with the data augmentation methods that I have been showing, but that's not good enough. Maybe we need more of less and one more shot learning or likes. But at the same time, be more exploiting big data or bigger data. Really what we have these days is not big data, but bigger. Also in our domain, where it's hardly happening. And yeah, finally, we want to move to less human involvement. I've already mentioned now automatic machine learning, but we really want to not only use end-to-end learning, but self-shape the whole network and not have to have templates put into this in the first place, but really have networks self-shaped. So we're on a good way to AIoT for health, and I want to just quickly thank all the teams involved in London, Augsburg, and Berlin and Munich from the company. Sorry for the company. Too many to put on the picture here. So you're only seeing the PhD and postdocs team members in London and Augsburg here. Thanks a lot to everybody. Thanks to all the fund givers. This is the lower part here, the current projects ongoing. And now I wanted to just have a quick advertisement. If you're interested in contributing, please be invited to consider Frontiers in Digital Health for your dissemination. We're running a COVID-19 special issue at the moment, and we're also running one on COVID-19 in the IEEE Journal on Synaptic Topics in Signal Processing. And with that, coming back to the last slide and thanking you very, very much again for the nice invitation and the honor to speak at this great team, to this great team. Thank you very much, Andreas, again. And thank you very much, everybody.
Yeah, Björn, thank you very much for this very nice presentation. I also prepared some applause for you, so I hope you can hear it. There's also plenty of people now clicking the applause button, but I hope the echo canceling didn't remove all of the applause. So hope it was recorded. So thank you very much. There have been already plenty of questions in the chat. And if you have any questions, please type them into the chat. I will now ask a couple of those. And I will start with the first one that is about the snoring classification, the deep spectrum, I believe. So I found it interesting that you have color maps in there, and you mentioned that the color maps have an influence on the actual performance. And I was wondering whether you can give us some hints which color maps actually work best, and whether this can actually be made a trainable part of the network as well, or any hints would be appreciated.
Yeah, all of that reveals my upbringing as an engineer, and often it feels very sleeves up and try what works. We figured that Viridis is the best color map. And Viridis, if you look into it, is a lot of green and blue tones or shades. That makes sense if you think about it, because these networks have been trained on a lot of blue sky and green grass. So it's what has been present a lot in the images. Now, if you think about it, this raises your question, of course. Can't we automate the color selection process? And also raises the question, can't we become independent of the color map and do something smart in augmentation? Yes, I'm sure we can do both. We haven't done any of these smarter things yet. But that's exactly what I mentioned in AutoML. We want to be smarter and less human testing involved in all of these aspects, and tailoring the network architecture, choosing color maps in transfer learning, and the likes.
I found it interesting because sometimes in medical imaging you also have the problems that you just have essentially black and white images, and then what people typically do is they simply copy the input three times. And I wonder if they could also have a benefit if they were using a color map instead in just copying the input. So the color map was better than just replicating the input three times.
Actually, we have been trying ensembles, and ensembles have been putting different things together, different time frequency representations or different ways to come up with an image. This could even be plots or feature contours or other things than just TF transforms. Mm-hmm. And we have been using different color maps. And then, of course, you're increasing the feature vector size like hell, and you can think of how to compress the feature vector, and you can use PCA, LDA, or whatever to try to get it smaller again, bilinear pooling or other things. At the end of the day, the ensembles did give an improvement, but it's not too sure if they justify the effort over using the one best from the ensembles.
I see.
But you're absolutely right. As you mentioned this, medical imaging was one of the very early ones where you used these pre-trained VGG and ResNets.
Exactly. So the problem somewhat sounds familiar.
Exactly. Yeah. So the more dramatic transfer here is simply coming from cross-modal transfer. But at the end of the day, it's simply by representing the problem as an image.
Yeah. So, but the Yeah, so it's a very different kind of image, of course, with the slice views and so on. But absolutely. So I also have seen that you used quite a lot of generative adversarial networks and conditional GANs and so on. And to my experience, these adversarial augmentation sometimes work when you have really small data sets. But as soon as you go to larger data sets, then typically the effectiveness or the benefit by the augmentation is not as strong. But I couldn't point you at what point it makes sense to use the GAN augmentation and at what point it doesn't. So I would assume that in speech you have similar observations, that if you do large vocabulary where you really have millions of hours of speech, the GAN might not be as efficient. Do you have a rule of thumb or an intuition when to use a GAN and at what point it doesn't make sense anymore?
I mean, the hope that we have is that we're better than just flipping and rotating or whatever in audio and speech, using Psola or alike to speed up or slow down without corrupting too much. And if that doesn't help, probably your GANs will not give you much advantage either, I would assume. We do, again, unfortunately not have any, like you said, cutting edge or cutoff point where we know that it makes sense or not. But we're also in the very unfortunate position that it always helps because for all of these problems, we simply have too small corpora. So it would be a luxury for us to have a task where we don't have this effect.
And did you compare that also to stuff like vocal tract length normalization and variations in speed and variations in background noise and so on?
Yeah, so that's what I meant by more similar, more simple transformations or augmentations approaches. Not systematically, I have to say. So we did it again, very sleeves up in engineering style. So we're absolutely right. They're missing these considerations in a more systematic review, meaning also across different speech analysis tasks, for example, and also comparing augmenting on feature or representation level versus on signal level. However, that all being said, this all is my firm belief that it makes sense to more tightly couple analysis and synthesis. And I keep saying we do not learn to understand speech only or recognize speech. We also learn to produce it. And I think it makes a lot of sense to couple both of these things much more tightly. GANs is just one tool for me to do that. But overall in AI, it seems very clear to me that we have to be much more coupling generation and understanding or recognition parts.
I agree, and I must say I found it very impressive that you can use this in order to convert different emotions using a conditional GAN, which is pretty cool idea. So Tomas also had a question, and in particular about the generation. So do you think it's possible to generate speech with different levels of nasality?
I would guess so. I mean, we would have to have something to train with it first. But then again, why not? I mean, if it's audible, and it is, yes, clearly we should be able to do that. Right about now, we're largely looking into emotion because emotion is always the biggest selling point. I would imagine that we try to do it really for augmentation, also in other health states, but why not?
Cool.